stand and join as we sing together, "Welcome Everybody." And some good news to share today. First off, I believe worship for next Sunday will be at 10 a.m., the usual time, and it will be an extra special service as we celebrate the baptisms of Darcy Livingston and of Cameron Ord. So hopefully you can all be present to celebrate their baptisms on what will be a really special day. The Community Interest Committee was letting you know that they have arranged for an Erskine Christmas cards to be on sale after church in the Aaron Hall on Sundays the 29th of October and the 5th of November. So Erskine will be grateful for that support, so keep that in mind coming up. The Dementia Cafe continues to meet on Friday afternoons between 2 and 3:30. All are invited and will be made most welcome. And good news, one piece is from the Guild for a sincere thank you to the gardening team for their hard work in making our church grounds so welcoming, inviting, and attractive, which I think we can all agree with. And so the Guild encourages the gardening team to enjoy their break, I believe, now that we're moving into cooler temperatures this winter. Is there any other good news to share? The sun is shining. We're here. That is good. Very good. Well, in the future, if you have good news to share, you can leave a note for David or I. He, of course, is leading the service at St. Ninian's this morning. And for future intimations, if you email those in by noon on Thursday so they can be included in the weekly updates. I guess that's all for just now, so we'll continue in our worship with singing hymn number 185, "Come Children, Join and Sing." You're invited to stand as you are able, and we'll all sing together.
Thank you.
forgot one intimation to make, which is that tonight at St. John's Church at 7 p.m., all are invited to go along and enjoy songs of praise, which I believe will feature the Connect Choir, and there will be lots of favorite hymns and other songs of praise. So that is tonight at St. John's at 7 p.m. You are all invited to that. And now we'll move to Young Church, and I see some young friends over here this morning. How's it going over here? Hi, how are you? Good, it's good to see you today. And I brought one of my favorite Bibles because it has nice pictures. Do you have a Bible with pictures in it? I think the pictures help. I like them. Very good. Can you see what's happening in this picture? What's on this table? Food. There's lots of yummy food on this table. But is there anybody sitting around the table? No, it's just this one guy. And does he look happy or sad? He looks kind of sad, right? Because there's nobody there. Nobody there to enjoy all that food. So I thought I would read you this story that Jesus told his friends. Because Jesus told lots of stories, right? To explain things and to help his friends learn about what he was teaching. So there was a man who decided to have a nice dinner. And when everything was ready, all the food was on the table, he sent his servant out to tell each guest that the dinner was ready for them. So have you ever had a party? Or have you ever been to a party? So I think some of us have been to parties, yeah? And we send invitations, we get invitations. So when the kings, yeah, sometimes we bring things to parties. So at the first house, the person said, I can't come. I just bought a farm and I must see it immediately. So please tell the host to excuse me. At the next house, the person said, I just bought a new team of oxen for my farm. I haven't seen them yet. I can't come to your party. Please tell the host to excuse me. And a third person said, I just got married. I can't come to your party. So the servant returned and told the host that no one could come to the dinner, and he was upset. What was he going to do? The house was ready. The food was cooked. It was all on the table, but none of the guests could come. So he said to the servant, if we can't fill the seats with guests I invited, then we will fill them with guests that I didn't think about inviting. Look for people who would like a really good meal. Invite anyone you see, the homeless woman, the blind teenager, the man who can't walk, who sits on the corner asking for coins. So the servant went out with a new guest list. He returned and told the man that all the people had been invited, and they were seated at the table, and there was still room for more. So the host was amazed. He told the servant to go out to the roads and alleys. He said, go to any place where you might find someone who wants a good meal and good people with whom to share it. I want my house to be filled with people who want to be here. The people I invited first are missing a really great meal. Oh, yeah. So in that story, we see that the host was sad at first. Nobody was coming. But then they went and invited other people that they hadn't first thought of. And that's kind of what God wants, right? God wants everyone to be included. God wants a full table where there's always room for more people. And that's how we are called to live too, to always make sure that we're including friends and people who maybe wouldn't normally be included, that we're always inviting them in. So I think we have some more interesting stickers on the ground than our Bible story today, but that's all right. So we will continue in our worship. We're all invited to stand and sing together our next hymn, number 153, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
to scripture to read about God's faithfulness. Our first reading comes from the Old Testament, the prophet Isaiah. Eleanor will read for us from chapter 25, verses 1 through 9.
Praise to the Lord. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done marvelous things, things planned long ago. You have made the city a heap of rubble, the fortified town a ruin, the foreigner's stronghold a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will honor you. Cities of ruthless nations will revere you. You have been a refuge for the poor, a refuge for the needy in his distress, a shelter from the storm and a shade from the heat. For the breath of the ruthless is like a storm driving against a wall and like the heat of the desert. You silence the uproar of foreigners as heat is reduced by the shadow of a cloud. So the song of the ruthless is stilled. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the shroud that enfolds all peoples, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove the disgrace of his people from all the earth. The Lord has spoken. In that day they will say, "Surely this is our God. We trusted in him and he saved us. This is the Lord. We trusted in him. Let us rejoice and be glad in his salvation." Amen.
Now let us join our hearts in prayer. We'll say the Lord's Prayer together at the end. Let us pray. Holy God, we come together today in your name to worship you, for we remember all of your wonderful works. As we gather, we come with both the burdens and the celebrations of our lives and of the world on our hearts and in our minds. We give thanks that you welcome us just as we are, with all that we carry, for the good news that you seek us out relentlessly with abundant grace and boundless mercy. For you call us to enter the joy of discipleship, the joy of following in your way. But we struggle to respond fully to this gracious invitation. So we seek your forgiveness, that we may know more deeply the joy you intend. God of perfect love, you continually bring forth life, transforming sadness to joy and despair to hope. Forgive us, redeem us, and transform us, O Lord. Restore us to the people you call us to be. And gracious God, make us aware of your presence in this place and all places. Illumine the words of Holy Scripture by your Spirit, that we might hear what you would have us hear and be who you would have us be. For the sake of Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh, and in whose name we pray, saying together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. And now we'll turn to our second reading, which comes from the New Testament. We're reading the same parable we told to the children. That one was in Luke's gospel, and now Eleanor will read from Matthew's gospel, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14.
The parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened calf have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the banquet. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, ill-treated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. Go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find." So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, both good and bad. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. "Friend," he asked, "how did you get in here without wedding clothes?" The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, "Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen." Amen. Thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word, and to his name be all the praise and the glory.
Thank you, Eleanor. Now we'll sing together again hymn number 604, Holy Wisdom, Lamp of Learning. The words might be unfamiliar, but I believe the tune you might know. So please rise as you're able and join as we sing together.
Thank you.
engaged in the spring of 2021, we knew that COVID would unfortunately likely have an impact on our wedding planning. But we were fortunate that our wedding ended up taking place after vaccines were readily available and in a window of time where case numbers were relatively low, so that we could safely have guests attend and celebrate our wedding with us. But unfortunately, most of my family from here in Scotland, and even some of David's family in the States, weren't able to make it because of COVID concerns around traveling or other reasons. So while we still had a wonderful day, we obviously missed those loved ones who weren't there in person. And I know a lot of people who had to change their wedding plans because of pandemic restrictions, either moving the date, sometimes more than once, or inviting fewer guests. COVID got in the way of a lot of celebrations and gatherings. There were some weddings in my family that I wasn't able to attend, and I was so disappointed to miss out. Because it's an honor to be invited to someone's wedding, and it usually turns out to be a pretty great party. So generally, when we receive a wedding invitation, we accept it, and we go, and we enjoy ourselves. Of course, there are reasons we might turn down an invitation to something, even if we really want to say yes, whether it be COVID or something else. We might also come up with an excuse to say no to an invitation simply because we don't want to go. But the situation that Jesus described in the parable we read today is something else altogether. It's important to remember when we read the parables of Jesus that they're not meant to be taken literally. This one in particular, full of hyperbole and kind of outlandish in its characters and their actions, is not a realistic morality tale. It's symbolic, it's an allegory where the different characters represent in an exaggerated way various people or groups of people in real life. So Jesus told this parable and the two before it after he had made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem on a donkey on what we know as Palm Sunday. He had already gone to the temple where he drove out those who were buying and selling, and he had cursed a fig tree. He was really making his presence known in the city. And so, of course, the religious authorities questioned him when he returned to the temple. They were skeptical and afraid of Jesus and his teachings because they threatened the status quo as they knew it. And as Jesus was in the habit of doing, he spoke to them in parables. And this one, about the wedding banquet, which is like the kingdom of heaven, is also told in Luke's gospel, which we shared with the children. And in Luke, the emphasis is very much on inclusion. After the first guest declined to attend the great dinner, the host explicitly invited those who would normally have been overlooked and excluded, the poor, the blind, the marginalized. And that theme of inclusion is also clear in Matthew's version that we read today, but the story is even more dramatic and kind of bizarre. The king invited people to his son's wedding banquet, but they would not come. And we have to ask ourselves, who would turn down an invitation from the king? Who had something better to do than attend a lavish feast? The responses of the invited guests making light of the invitation and going to their farm or their business or even killing the king's messengers is ridiculous. It doesn't make any sense that people would act like that. And then the king reacted in an equally absurd way, destroying their city before instructing his messengers to go and invite anyone they could find in the streets to the banquet, both good and bad, the text tells us, so that finally the wedding hall was filled with guests. But then we get to the part in Matthew that's not in Luke's telling of this story. The king went in to see his guests and saw that there was a person not wearing a wedding robe. Now we can assume that because all of these guests had just been invited off the streets, they wouldn't have had wedding attire at the ready. They would have been given robes to wear when they arrived. So this guy apparently just refused to put on the robe that he was given. And when asked by the king how he got in without a robe, the man was speechless, and the king had him thrown out in yet another dramatic turn of events. The guests who ended up attending the wedding were not there because they were on the VIP list. They weren't on any list. They were not there because of their wealth or power or status. They were there because they got invited and they showed up. And we can assume that the ones who did put on their wedding robes that they were given enjoyed this magnificent feast. And if we think about why this one guest refused to wear a wedding robe, there are several possibilities, but ultimately the result is the same. He didn't appear to be fully participating in the celebration. He wasn't living into the joyfulness of the feast. He wasn't taking the event seriously and joining in the festivities in the appropriate way. So when we think about this parable, which is about the kingdom of heaven, and what this specific part represents, it's almost as if the robeless guest is like someone who has been called by God and who has received God's grace, but who doesn't joyfully and humbly put on Christ in response, as Paul puts it in Romans. In other words, they have been given the unfathomable gift of God's grace and love, but they don't change how they live or how they treat others. They don't respond in a way fit for the kingdom of heaven by living according to how they have been called, which is with joy and gratitude, with sharing that love and grace with others. Because there is joy in the kingdom of heaven, in the fact that we are all invited to God's table, not because of anything we have done or because we are good or bad, but because God has graciously invited us to it and has made a place for each of us. Of course, this is made abundantly clear and tangible when we celebrate communion, and the invitation includes the words, "This is the Lord's table. This is the joyful feast of the people of God, and Jesus Christ invites us to it." I think I've shared before, but when I was in seminary preparing to become a minister, I served at a church where we celebrated communion every week. And the bread for communion was always delicious, but on Easter, one of the other ministers insisted that we had to use pound cake or like angel food cake for communion because Easter is a party and you can't have a party without cake. So we talk about celebrating the sacrament of communion because it is a celebration. What we remember at this table, that is the hope we have in Jesus and the promise of God's kingdom, that's worth celebrating. It's the reason that we know joy at all. And this idea of a joyous feast appears throughout Scripture. This notion that we are promised a place at God's table is central to our faith and our hope. You'll notice that our reading from Isaiah also mentions a feast, with this passage coming from the apocalyptic part of that book. The prophet describes the eschatological hope of the people, the future fulfillment of God's promises, which involves the Lord making a feast for all peoples on the mountain. On that day, the people will say, "This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." So again, we see that there is joy in the feast that God prepares for all of God's people. But I admit that I felt a little uncomfortable when I was preparing this sermon and was feeling called to talk about joy, because there is so much that is terrible happening in the world. My social media is filled with people who just feel sad and hopeless and heartbroken about what is happening in Israel and Gaza and other places. How do we think about joy, let alone feel joy, when there is so much brokenness? But the thing is that joy does not ignore pain or pretend that suffering is not happening. It's not about just putting on a happy face and forcing cheerfulness. Joy is deeper than that. As Christians, our joy, like our hope, comes from who God is, from what God has done and is doing and will do. Like hope in the face of hopelessness, we know there is still joy, even in the face of sorrow and pain and suffering. Largely because of social media, I think, and the way the rest of our media works, where we only hear short sound bites and only see the headlines and the hot takes, I think in some ways we as a society have lost the ability to hold two ideas at the same time, to understand that so many situations are not either or, but both and. As much as we want things to be black and white, the reality is that we spend most of our time living in the grayness. There is evil and there is also good. There is brokenness and there is also beauty. There is fear and violence and there is also hope. There is suffering and there is also joy, because we need all of those good things. We don't have to be happy all the time. The book of Ecclesiastes reminds us that there is a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Paul's letter to the Romans instructs us to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. But still, we cannot lose sight of the joy we find in Christ. The good news is that God invites each of us and all of us to a magnificent feast in the kingdom of heaven. There's a place for every single one of us at God's table, and there is always room for one more. And in response to that good news, we are called to put on Christ, to live accordingly with joy and humility and thanksgiving, with knowledge of the grace God has shared with us, with extending that same grace to those around us, so that all may experience love and justice and peace, so that our world and the hearts of all of God's people may be filled with joy. Amen. We'll sing together now our next hymn from Mission Praise number 651, "The Kingdom of God is Justice and Joy." Please rise as you are able.
Thank you.
blessing in the world, instead replaced by violence and fear and evil. The news out of the Middle East is unspeakable. The devastation from the earthquake in Afghanistan is unthinkable. And those are just two stories of many that we even know about. So as we pray, we particularly remember the people of Israel and Palestine, of Afghanistan and Ukraine, and all places where there is suffering. So let us join our hearts in prayer, beginning with a moment of quiet to center ourselves in God's presence and to remember those people and situations that are closest to our hearts. Let us pray. Great God, in you is more love than we can imagine and more grace than we can fathom. You have shown yourself in Jesus Christ as a God who meets us where we are and loves us as we are. While there is much brokenness around us, we remain a people of hope, and we are glad for this day and grateful for your many gifts. You bring good things into our lives more than we can name, more than we can number. You give us the bread of life, sustaining our souls and feeding our deepest hungers. You accompany us on our way. Thank you for your abundant faithfulness. Our hearts are full with many things today. Disease and death and pain and sorrow are constantly among us. The journey through these days is marked by uncertainty and heartache. We are frequently overwhelmed by the needs around us and within us. Some need healing, some need encouragement, some need comfort, some need safety. We all need hope and peace and joy. So we turn to you asking you to hear our prayers and grant what we need for the living of these days. We pray for your world, O God, for the earth you created for our home. Help us to care for the planet and all the creatures who live upon it, to protect and preserve the beauty and resources around us so that all may have access to clean water and air and soil, so that this and future generations would have a safe place to live. We pray for our nation and for all nations, for our leaders and for all leaders. We pray for renewed commitments to our common life. Refresh us in the values of your heart: justice, righteousness, compassion, mercy, and peace. Help us to find a unity of purpose as citizens and neighbors that all may experience abundant life. And we pray for your church in places near and far. May the waters of your grace continually refresh and empower us to extend the love of Jesus to all people. We pray for the clarity of our witness as your people, for this congregation and our life together, for our efforts to follow in the way of Jesus. With gratitude for your faithfulness and with thanksgiving for all that we have received, we bring our gifts to you, O God, and pray that you would use them and us for your purposes in building your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. We'll sing in a moment our final hymn. The choir will sing the first verse and the chorus, and then all are invited to stand and join and sing together. And then, of course, we'll have our benediction and our sung blessing. But now let us sing together hymn number 685, For Everyone Born.
Our shelter, our space, a song.
justice and in joy to love and serve the Lord. And as you do, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and always. Now go in peace. Momentary.
Okay, this half, follow me. We'll go first. And this side, follow the choir. And we'll sing it twice through. Now go in peace, now go in love. From the Father above, Jesus Christ the Son, stay with you till the day is done. Holy Spirit, encircle you in all you think and do. Once again, God's blessing be with you. Amen. Now go in peace, now go in love. Father above, Jesus Christ the Son, stay with you till the day is done. Holy Spirit, encircle you.